Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Excited to kick off our webinar on marketing in medical tourism. This is a special passion of mine because I feel that medical tourism we've really only tapped in to 1 or 2% of the potential of this industry. It's still an extremely untapped industry. There's not a lot of innovation that we see in regards to how we market and approach this industry. And so there's still a huge job, we have to do together as an industry to make more consumers aware of medical tourism, to make more buyers aware, and to make it easier for people to enter this industry and to do business. And, so with that, what I've seen on the marketing side is in the last 15 years, nothing has really changed. People are still trying to approach consumers in the same way with, not real success, lackluster results, trying stuff. There's a lot of short-term marketing in this industry where people just put in a little money, test the market, see if they get patients. And if they don't, they don't invest anymore. And so in the end, they don't really have a sustainable initiative. Any marketing initiative requires sustainability and consistency. It requires constant attention, constant changes to how you're approaching the marketplace. We're currently redesigning all of our sites into one site, which Brandon's going to be talking about a little bit later. And, in that, one of the fascinating things is we peeled back the onion and looking at all the websites in medical tourism in the industry, and really some of the more leading ones, companies that have raised 5 million, 10 million, 15 million US dollars, is that there's actually no science behind how people are marketing to consumers. And you have to really constantly update and pivot and change your plans to how the consumers are interacting with either your website or your marketing initiatives. So this, I wanted to finish up our year strong with a marketing webinar and then continually update this throughout the year. This is Brandon Fertig, who runs our marketing and digital strategy here at the Medical Tourism Association. He gave this workshop in Abu Dhabi at our World Medical Tourism and Global Healthcare Congress that just happened a few weeks ago. It was a full workshop, was really successful. And so we wanted to kind of duplicate that success because I think that very few people in the industry have an understanding of what I should do to market, how I should make this happen. And I think going 15 years in the industry since when the Medical Tourism Association started, and people are still doing the same thing they did 15 years ago, they're still also not investing or doing short-term investing. We realized we need to break down the barriers of education and knowledge to make it easier for people to understand how they can market. Breaking down the barriers was the theme of our conference a few weeks ago, and it is the theme of, I think, what we're going to be rolling with in 2020. And so I think that most organizations in this industry don't know what I should have on my website, how I should try to capture leads on my website, how I should try to engage people through emails, how I should engage consumers through drip campaigns over a period of time so that they actually convert into a patient. What do I do once I get a patient lead? There's so many different, what advertising campaigns should I do? Should I use Google? Should I use Facebook? Should I use Instagram? What terms do I market under? At what point do I stop marketing under a specific keyword or campaign or social media channel? There's so many questions that come into play with this. And one, I feel very few people have the answer and that there's no education in this. And so excited to bring this to you so that you guys can maybe have new ideas you can implement before the end of the year, or have new concepts and ideas that you can roll out for the first quarter of next year. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Brandon to kick it off.
Good morning, everyone. Wherever you are in the world, maybe it's good morning, maybe it's good evening, but It's great to have you here. I'm so glad that you've decided to join us. As you can see, if we just back up a step, this presentation today is all about marketing medical tourism. And we're going to talk about why you might not be generating patient leads. My name is Brandon. As Jonathan said, thank you so much for the introduction. I oversee all of our marketing and branding at Medical Tourism Association and Global Healthcare Resources. So I want to first learn a little bit about who's with us today. I want to learn a little bit about you. So we actually have a poll, and I would like to know which best describes your organization. If you take a look at your screen, a poll should have just came up, and choose what fits you best. If you're not on the list, you can skip this one. Unfortunately, I only had an option, only had five options. I couldn't put a sixth one, but I think this covers mostly everybody that's with us today. So a lot of hospitals, a lot of facilitators. Yep, that's expected. And it looks like everybody's really, we have a very good level of engagement today. So that's great, because I would really like us to start using the chat throughout this presentation. I'll cue you when that time comes, but I'm really glad that already over 80% of people have voted. So a lot of facilitators, a lot of hospitals. We'll give it just a couple more seconds. And that's great. Fantastic. Very interesting. Okay. So let's talk about what we will talk about. So the introduction that John just gave was a fantastic introduction. I think he raised some points that you should keep in the back of your mind, and that we'll be also addressing during this presentation. And we'll also have a little bit of a evolution of medical tourism recap. We're just gonna talk about the industry and where it's gone, where it's been, where it's going. We're gonna talk about the digital impact of healthcare. Then we're going to talk about seven practical marketing concepts, and that's going to be fun. You're going to have a lot of fun there. And then we're going to talk about testing to find a winner, because once we've got all these concepts, testing is the name of the game. Jonathan said that a lot of people don't know what works. They don't know what they're doing. And that's the point here. That is what we're going to cover here. And we're going to talk about how you can know what you're doing as a marketing professional, or even most of the people here probably are not marketing professionals. So somebody who is involved, even if you're a doctor, no matter what level of the organization you're involved with the obtaining of patients in some way, shape, or form. And then we're gonna talk about some opportunities for you. So let's jump right in. So governments, now and then, once upon a time, there were just a few countries that were doing medical tourism, but now, there's a lot more countries, and that means that you have more competition. So there's a plus side and there's a downside to this. The plus side is that the downside is you've got competition. You have to actually know what you're doing if you want to succeed in medical tourism. If you want to actually be bringing patients in from other areas in the world, you have to know what you're doing. The upside to that, though, is that your competition hasn't caught on yet. The strategies that we're going to be talking about today, the things that we're going to discover on this webinar are not exactly public knowledge, and the whole industry hasn't caught on yet. So that's the upside to that. And same thing goes for facilitators. Once upon a time, just a few, and now a lot more. And the same things hold true that I just mentioned. I don't need to tell you that global healthcare is a $1 billion or a great opportunity. It's a $100 billion industry. And if you can have just a sliver of that, I think you'd agree that you would be in a very good place. So let's talk about the medical traveler of today. Just some basic foundational questions or statistics, I should say. So 90% of medical travelers engage in tourism activities. You have to know that. You have to know, as somebody who's in the healthcare field that is interested in medical travel, you have to know that it's not just medical traveler. Traveling, it's medical tourism. The tourism component is huge, and that statistic proves it. And 83% of those patients are actually traveling with a companion. 80% of the demand for medical tourism is driven by cost savings. That's something that you'll want to keep in the back of your mind, because that can play into how you're doing your marketing. And we know that at least $7,000 on average is being spent by medical tourists, and that's overall, that's US dollars, and that's overall per trip. So this guy right here, this guy can be your patient. He can be. But first, you have to attract that patient. You have to take him. You have to take him. Excuse me. You have to take his attention, and you have to convince him that he's going to get an amazing patient experience at your hospital. Remember, medical tourism is not something that you can just put out there and say, "Hey, we take, we're a hospital in Greece, and we take American patients." That means nothing to me as an American patient. There has to be a reason why I'm going to actually want to go to Greece and go to your hospital for care, right? So even though that's a foundational truth and it seems so simple, let's keep that in the back of our minds. How are you attracting patients right now? 87% of the industry, this was a poll that we did. We did a survey amongst medical tourism professionals. It was a small sample size, somewhere between 100 and 150 professionals, and 87% said that marketing and advertising is important. But half of the industry still relies on word of mouth. So there's definitely an opportunity for some change. I'd like to know, how are you attracting patients? What has been the most successful way that you, at your clinic or your hospital, or as a facilitator, or as a government, or even as an employer that is sending patients, how have you engaged with your patients? If you open up your chat and you want to just leave a little note for us to see, that would be very interesting. So maybe it's digital marketing, maybe it's word of mouth, but just chime in on the chat and I'm going to keep going. But it would be great to have an understanding of what everybody is doing that's working on this webinar. Okay. Here's where it gets fun. We have traditional marketing and we have digital marketing. Now, I don't know the level of background marketing knowledge in this webinar here today. So I think it's worth discussing what the two are. So traditional marketing are these mediums that have been around forever, at least in the past, with the exception of television within the past century or so, right? We've got newspaper, we've got radio, television, direct mail, billboards. These are all traditional means of advertising. And then we've got digital marketing, we've got digital advertising, and that's things like email and live chat, which is super underutilized, by the way. Live chat on your website, chatbots, that's a whole nother webinar, but that is something that is severely underutilized, and the opportunity is really great for that. Your website, which is your flagship of marketing. SEO, which stands for search engine optimization, that is how your website is appearing when people go searching for knee replacement in Greece, for example. Search ads, very similar, goes hand in hand with SEO, except SEO is what we call organic. It's on the organic side, meaning that it's all without using any funds. Search ads, the word advertising will always allude to paid opportunities typically. And so search ads are paying for those spots that you can't maybe get with organic SEO, search engine optimization. And then we have social advertising, which is the ads that you see all day long on your Facebook feed, on Instagram, on Twitter, on LinkedIn, on Pinterest, all these social platforms where we have paid opportunities. And for the purpose of this presentation, we're going to focus mostly on social advertising, and we're going to hone in on Facebook. And the reason why is because Facebook is the most widely used platform as far as social media goes globally. And so in order to properly communicate and convey the message today, I want to hone in on one thing, and that's just going to be Facebook. So we're not going to talk about email, we're not going to talk about search ads, although these things are necessary, especially search ads, especially in healthcare. So I don't want to sweep these under the rug. I think it's worth noting that if you're in healthcare and you want patients, you have to invest in search. But for the purpose of today's experience, we're going to focus, just so you know, on Facebook. If you're in another country like Russia or China, where Facebook is perhaps limited, well, the good news is that you have your own social networks, and the concepts that we're going to be discussing today will still apply. So great news for you. Now, just to really hammer this home, as we might say in America, we want to really convey the if we back up here, why did we get in this? What is the significance of this conversation about traditional versus digital means of marketing and advertising? That is very important to know. Traditional marketing, you are likely already doing, right? If you're a hospital, you probably, if you've been around for some time, you've probably been doing newspapers and billboards and radio and other, depending on your facility, the size of your facility, the location you are in the world, you're probably familiar with these forms of advertising. Now, these forms of advertising, many marketers will tell you are useless. Traditional marketing, don't spend any money on it. Don't spend any money on any of these things. And I'm not going to tell you that because I think they still have their place if they're used strategically. The good news here is that while we're focusing on digital marketing and what we're going to talk about with our ad testing and marketing concepts, specifically in social advertising, if we can figure out what works, right? This whole thing is about finding a winning concept. Once we find that winning concept and we know what works, now we can apply that to everything else. So we have a campaign with a with creative, we'll get into what all these words mean, but with creative and with visuals and an ad that works, we have an ad that works. Now we can take that ad, because we know it works, we can take that ad and we can now apply it to our other marketing channels. We can apply it to our billboard, we can apply it to our newspaper ads, right? Okay, so I wanna make it very clear that digital marketing is very important, and you're going to see that in this next video on this slide. But I'm not here to tell you to stop what you're doing with traditional. So hopefully our sound plays. Let me know in the chat if you have any issues. But this is an example of how prominent and how important digital advertising is. So if you're not doing digital advertising, I hope that this video alone conveys the message. It is clearly a group of Americans, and we like our Super Bowl, our football, American football, and this is going to illustrate that. Oops, sorry.
Introducing the Fuego Burrito. Wild caught seasoned rice beans in a blend of three fiery cheeses. So if you're hungry for danger, hurry.
So all that just to illustrate the point that traditional advertising is being phased out because people are obsessed with that thing in their hands. And that's why we're going to leverage that. We're going to leverage the psychology of the culture around the world in which people are obsessed with that thing in their hands. And we're going to make sure that they're seeing our message. They're not looking down or looking away when our message comes on. So let's talk about the digital impact of healthcare. So 5% of all searches, that's all searches, that's everything on the web, are health related. And that's a pretty good number. That means 5 out of 100 people are searching for something healthcare related. Search drives 3 times more visitors to hospital sites than non-search. You need to be considering search engine optimization organically and also paid search. 77% of patients, they run a search before even scheduling an appointment. That's a huge number, big statistic. Hope you see that as an eye opener. In the US alone, we're going to be spending about $3.1 billion on healthcare. Now, what's interesting about that statistic is that healthcare is actually the most underspent category in digital advertising across all sectors. So again, what that tells me is that we are looking at an incredible opportunity to seize the market, because the market hasn't caught on yet. And that's even in the US, where most things digital are widely accepted, right? Everybody's using their credit card all over the web. We're purchasing things left and right. You know, it's the culture here is very receptive to ads and digital purchases. And so that number and how that relates to other sectors should tell you something. It tells you there's opportunity. The average cost for a healthcare lead is $286. That's US dollars. Depending where you're at, you might say, yep, sounds like what I'm paying, or you might say, wow, that's an incredible number, and you know, I can't believe people are paying that for lead. Well, hopefully what you're going to learn today, you can deploy and reduce that average cost in your own organization. 70% of patients spend time researching. They're researching what they've got going on. They're researching that knee pain that they've got before they even contact the healthcare provider, right? So what does this tell you? Again, this is the psychology of our culture worldwide. It's that we are obsessed with the information age. There's information out there. And if you can be one of those results, right? If you can be one of those in a list full of search results, if you can be one of those, then you will be in a very good place. So this is very interesting, and this comes back to the poll, the survey that we did earlier, that Pulse survey. 55% of medical tourism professionals told us that that they're actually converting at 15% or less, which makes sense. What doesn't make sense is the elites here, where 10% of those people, which is actually a very good chunk, is actually converting at a whopping 46% or more. That is an insane statistic, and there is possibility that it could be, could be a little bit skewed, because maybe somebody is answering that question based on a qualified lead and not just all leads. But if we're converting, could you imagine you're getting inquiries on your website and one out of every two inquiries is converting like that? It's probably not likely, so I don't want to encourage you in that direction. It's unlikely with any form of marketing. However, what this tells me, regardless of how the recipients perceived the question and whether or not they were honest about the leads that they're getting and how they're converting them, it tells me that what we already know, you and I already know without having data. It tells us that there is a percentage of every industry that is doing very well. And so here's how I believe that you can do very well. How do you join the top percent, 10%? This is not the focus of our presentation. All this is leading up to the focus here, but these are foundational truths, I believe. You need to have a beautiful and a functional website. We're not gonna get too deeply into the website here, but without a website, the website is your flagship. It's your foundation. It's the foundation. Before you can build a skyscraper, you need the foundation, and the website is that foundation. If you don't have the website, the first thing that you need to do when this webinar ends today is you need to start thinking about how you can get a website, whether it's for your hospital or clinic or your facilitation business. Whatever it is, you absolutely need a website, and I would say 99% of the people here with us today probably have that. You need a strong social media presence. Social proof is huge. What social proof means is when people see reviews, when people see action going on, when people see that Susie had a great knee surgery or arthroscopic surgery in Greece, went fantastic, and she saw these beautiful sights, and she's got pictures with the Parthenon, right? Because it's a tourism experience. At the same time, people are going to see that and say, they're going to say a couple things that you could probably guess. I would imagine a large percentage will probably say, wow, that's pretty amazing. I've never even considered traveling for medical tourism, for healthcare. That is a battle that we'll have to face as an industry, as clinics and hospitals and facilitators and governments. The entire world isn't exactly exposed to this idea of medical tourism. It's still being caught on to. I think over the past decade, we've seen a tremendous increase in the understanding and the knowledge that you can actually go elsewhere for healthcare. And I think the numbers represent that. However, there are going to be a lot of people who have just never even considered it, that I can go and I can see the Parthenon, and while I'm seeing the Parthenon, I can get my knee taken care of, or whatever the case is. We're just using simple examples, but part of this is going to be awareness, industry awareness, opening the eyes of our industry. And so assuming we've got our website down, assuming we've got our social media presence down, which I believe most people here do, now we got to look at a successful advertising campaign, which I know for sure most organizations do not have. And so you need to be able to, especially in this industry, we need to accept that we need to spend some money to make money if we really want to make some real money. And so who wouldn't want to do that anyway? Who wouldn't want to spend $1 to make $2? Who wouldn't want to spend $1 to make $5? Whatever that number is, whatever that ROI looks like, if you're producing a return on that investment, that's what ROI stands for those of us who are unaware, return on investment. If you're getting a return on your investment, that's a great investment, right? And if we have a winning marketing concept, it's going to pave the way for everything. It's going to pave the way for everything. We're going to talk about that in about 2 minutes. We're getting there. So it's good to know. I just want to make us aware that there's a customer lifestyle, There's a lifestyle too, but there's a life cycle. And the life cycle of the customer, which in this case for you all is the patient. We can't really get into the details or every single stage on this webinar. We might have to save some of these for other events. However, what we're going to focus on here is the attraction stage. A big part of why you're not getting patient leads is because you're not attracting them in the first place. You can't convert the second stage right here. You can't get to the conversion stage if you're not attracting them first. So the conversion stage is something that you need to optimize, and it's worth talking about. It's why we're spending a little bit of time here right now. And you know, once you're attracting patients, you actually have to convert them. You have to convert the potential lead into an actual patient. And that's where a lot of drop off comes. But most of us, honestly, if we're not even attracting the patients. So the focus today is on the attract phase. Okay, so here we go. 7 marketing concepts we're going to discuss today. Each one has its own video: convenience, demographics, ripple effects, satire, partnerships, storytelling, pricing. All of these concepts are concepts that I think I'm hoping that you're sitting there on the other side of this computer screen and you're going to say, wow, this matches up with who we are as an organization. If you're a clinic, if you're that clinic that focuses on knee replacements and or whatever that or orthopedics are in Greece, then you know, I don't know what your unique value proposition is, and I don't know if you know that either. I don't know if everybody here even knows what that word means, but what separates your clinic from all of the other clinics, whether that's in Greece or around the world? What is special about your clinic? What is your unique value proposition? The good news is, if you don't already have that, if you do have it, you can use what we're going to talk about to figure out exactly how you tweak that message. If you don't have it, you should have it. You need to have it. You need to know that, and your entire company needs to know. This is not a marketing thing. This is everybody in your company needs to know what sets you apart in your clinic, in your region, if you're a government, whatever that might be. So the reality is that if you don't have it, by testing concepts, by paying attention to what we're about to talk about, you can actually figure out what that might be, because once you test it, you're going to get a result, and that result is going to tell you what works. So you're going to be in good shape even if you don't have it. So once again, we've got some videos coming up. Hopefully the sound is playing just fine on your end. Like I said, let me know. If not, I don't see anything coming in, so we should be in good shape. I want to warn you, we have a lot of people from around the world here. Not everybody speaks perfect English. You're going to figure it out by the end of the video, but in the beginning, I just want to assure you that there is no foul language used here, but it's a play on language that makes you pay attention. It's a marketing tool. And all of these videos, the majority of these videos, use humor to really capture your attention just in different ways. But the underlying concept here is convenience. So take a look.
Ship my pants right here. Ship my pants, you're kidding.
You can ship your pants right here.
You hear that? I can ship my pants for free.
Wow, I just may ship my pants.
Yeah, ship your pants. Billy, you can ship your pants too.
I can't wait to ship my pants, Dad.
I just shipped my pants, and it's very convenient.
Very convenient.
I just shipped my drawers.
I just shipped my nightie.
I just shipped my bed.
If you can't find what you're looking for in store, we'll find it at Kmart.com right now and ship it to you for free.
So you know what the first thing is that comes to mind when I think of convenience and healthcare? again, just an example. We can't cover everything, but just one example is telehealth, right? How can, if my clinic, if my hospital, if my organization, my insurance company, whatever it might be, if we have telehealth involved, how can we use that? Well, telehealth is all about convenience, right? That's the name of the game. And so using convenience is a good way, even though you're not a telehealth company, you might be a hospital that has telehealth. And maybe that's a big part, that digital healthcare is a big part of what you offer. And that is something that you can test. You can see if that really resonates with your target market. We can find out if convenience is something that that people really want and they are attracted, they're coming through the door because of that convenience that you offer. And here's another one. And this one is all about partnerships. So it's how can we align our brand with another brand?
Good morning, all. Time to get into a beautiful song on this beautiful Sunday morning.
Get your free pocket-sized St. John Ambulance First Aid Kit and Basic First Aid Guide, because you never know when you're going to need it. Only with the Sun Hill this Sunday.
So what did we just witness? We witnessed a medical supply company teaming up with a local newspaper. So using partnerships is a great way to boost your brand, to boost your credibility. Let's say I'm a new hospital that just opened up. I'm a new clinic that just opened up. Let's now see, where can I align my brand? What other organizations can I align my brand? What's going to boost my credibility? Because now if I'm running ads, if I'm this new hospital clinic, nobody eating, this is majorly important for local, let alone regional, let alone global. I'm the new guy on the block, and how can I nothing happens overnight, but how can I much more quickly boost my credibility and start bringing on patients when I'm just so new and nobody knows the name of my organization? Well, how can you align your organization with another that is established, that is credible? And maybe that's simply just a newspaper, like the simple example here, or maybe that is another clinic that specializes in something differently that you can partner with. Or maybe you're a facilitator and you're the new facilitator on the block, and you're aligning yourself with hospitals that people know. You're aligning yourself with Cleveland Clinic or any of the such. So partnerships is another concept that you can test, that you can use. And then we've got demographics. So demographics, that's just a fancy word to describe the characteristics the inherent characteristics usually of a target market. So in this example, we will see an insurance company focusing specifically on women. Now, whether or not you feel that it's right or wrong, if you're a woman and you're watching this, hopefully you're laughing, but hopefully you're also saying, that's really interesting. Let me find out what they're all about. They specialize in women. Interesting. Oh, I'm sorry, I clicked out again. Sorry for interrupting that again, but as you can see at the end, the whole joke here is that guys are stupid. That's why we're only insuring women. So however you feel about that, they're getting the attention of women with a commercial like that. They're focused on a demographic and they're going after that demographic. Here's one that's not really funny, but it is very, 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 very useful. Storytelling. Now, what I want you to think about in the back of your mind is the story being told is of one of your patients. This is a patient that has gotten surgery at your hospital. This is a patient that you've sent overseas to receive care. And this is, imagine, a testimonial. This is a person describing their patient experience. This can be very beneficial. And look past the fact that there's cartoons and animations. It can be a simple video where it's somebody like me sitting right here telling my story. If you want to go to the next level and you want to add animations and stuff to it, that's fantastic. That will engage people even more so, and it will make you look a lot more professional and credible, and you can do it fairly cheaply. And you can ask me about that later if you're interested. But what I want you to think about here is patient testimonials.
My name is David Beckham, and this is my story. I've still looked back to 98. Of course, I wish it hadn't happened. And I sort of reacted as a young boy. I think I cried for about 5 or 10 minutes, literally. I was having death threats. I never felt safe for 3.5 years. It can knock a person down so much that they just go under. After I scored the goal against Greece, all the sports writers, they just stood up and started clapping me. To have that from the harshest critics, that was a huge thing. You will go through tough times. It's about coming through that.
So this company is, notice most all of these are these are companies that are using these commercials. These are actual real commercials. And so I believe this is actually an Adidas commercial. So what sort of concept are they using? Yes, they're using storytelling, but within that, they're actually using inspiration. They're using emotion. They're trying to elicit an emotional response. So just think about how, if it's not clicking with you yet, think about how on slide one, or our first concept, we looked at convenience. Think about testing convenience against a patient testimonial, for example, right? We can literally keep it that simple. We can literally run one campaign where we have one ad set that is focused on the convenience. It's focused on, hey, we offer, we'll pick you up at your airport, we'll pick you up at the hotel. We're focused on convenience of healthcare. And then on the other hand, we're simply just telling a story. We're not even telling the story before we're telling the story. Now it's our patient telling the story. Now it's our patient saying, they picked me up at the airport. They dropped me off at the hospital. They have wonderful food. Their beds are so comfortable. Whatever the case is, you can test those against each other and you can say, wow, one works really well, the other not so much. So the other we're not going to spend money on anymore because we figured out it doesn't work very well against this one. And that's dumbing it down. I don't think advertising is that simple, but I'm just trying to paint a black and white picture for you so you start to understand, because again, I realize not everybody here in the room is a marketing person, and I want to respect that, and I want to be able to have you take something away from this. So our next one, I keep hitting the keyboard when I have to use the mouse. Our next one is the ripple effect. I'm going to show a couple here. There's going to actually be three videos in one here. The reason why is because I think this is a very, very useful concept. By the way, not all of these have to be videos. We're using videos because I think it creates an engaging experience for you, but you can use text, headlines, images. This isn't all about TV. It's not all about video. That's just how we're illustrating the point. But the ripple effect, we're going to show two negative outcomes and one positive outcome. And so what that means, what does that mean to you? Well, if I'm a dental clinic, I might use in my advertising a picture of a guy with no teeth, for example, and show how this is the outcome of not visiting your dentist. That's a very simple example of a negative outcome. A positive outcome, I can show a woman with beautiful teeth, smiling, pearly white teeth, who doesn't drink coffee like myself. And what we can do is we're triggering that emotional, that psychological response that says, huh, I'm thinking about my teeth. I would love to have teeth like her, or I don't want to have teeth like him. You know, we're triggering that response, and we can use those responses in our marketing. So let's watch three videos.
Why are you checking your credit score? You don't live with mom and dad.
For not healthcare related, again. She's living with her mom. She's living with her mom because she's got bad credit.
Credit karma. Don't worry. It's free.
Credit karma.
Showing the outcome of bad credit. and a positive outcome. And this one is healthcare related. Think associations and outcomes. Now, what a great example that was, right? That's a perfect example. It's a hospital that's promoting their eye surgery, right? And they're using the ripple effect or the domino effect or associations and outcomes to be able to illustrate the point that, you know, you're going to have amazing vision once we're done with you. Once we take care of you, your eyes are going to be great. And they're using comedy to do that as well. Now we've got pricing.
Why are you checking your credit score?
Pricing. So the cost might be your unique value proposition. If it is, you probably already know that, meaning that if you're a clinic or a hospital specifically that is that has lower price treatments, you're probably already promoting that because you already know it. You see the value in promoting that. That is your unique value proposition. That's how you're separating yourself from your competition. And so here's just one more way that you might be able to use that concept and test that concept. Maybe throw some humor in there. It doesn't have to be like this, but put some, combine it with some humor to illustrate the point that that pricing is something that your patients should consider when seeking healthcare treatments with you.
Oh, I hate these big ass prices. Sounds like you could do some big ass savings.
I'd love some big ass savings.
Kmart Shop Your Way members save 30 cents a gallon.
30 cents a gallon? That's a big ass discount.
Big ass discount.
A really big ass discount.
Really big ass discount.
Honey, this solves your big ass problem.
Totally solves my big ass problem.
Dad, look at that big ass truck.
Big ass.
Shop Your Way members get big ass savings. Save 30 cents a gallon when you spend $50 or more at Kmart.
So get your attention. At the end of the day, that commercial is going to get your attention. Why? Because it's funny, because they do a play on profanity, and because they're saying, hey, you want to save some money on your gas? Come to Kmart. Now, what a great strategy for Kmart, because if you're living in the US like myself, I had no idea that Kmart has a gas station. So what a great way to build awareness. It makes you pay attention. And last but not least, we have satire. Now, satire can be used improperly. Satire is one you have to be careful with. I think all of you will laugh and appreciate this video for what it is. This is not a commercial. This was just a funny video that makes fun of healthcare. But the idea of satire would be kind of poking fun at your industry, as we're going to see now. And you'd have to figure out, how can we do that? Because people would definitely pay attention to satire. How can we do that, though, respectfully? How can we do that without offending patients or colleagues or whatever the case is? But this is definitely one of the strategies that will, that if you can use it properly, you will definitely get people to pay attention.
Fiji, Bora Bora, Dubai. You can spend tens of thousands per night for an exotic, expensive vacation. But if you're really wanting to spend serious money on a getaway, then why not spend 3 nights in a hospital without health insurance? Staying in a hospital without health insurance starts at an average of $10,000 per night. For just $10,000 per night, you'll get the finest amenities, like remote, one for the bed, one for the nurse, and of course, one for a state-of-the-art television with almost 20 channels. With your $10,000 per night, enjoy the finest cuisine, like macaroni and cheese, a fried chicken patty, vanilla wafers, pudding, and best of all, Salisbury steak. Your $10,000 per night will get you your own private room. Maybe, not always. And you'll probably be sharing a bathroom with a sick person you've never met. Hope that's cool. If not, just go in the bed. If your family or loved ones wants to come along, they'll be pampered too. Your $10,000 per night will get them one semi-comfortable chair where they can sleep sitting up with their shoes on until their back hurts. Your hospital room comes with the finest of toiletries, like this $1,000 toothbrush and this $629 Band-Aid. Your $10,000 per night also covers your wardrobe, like this stupid-looking muumuu that doesn't even cover your butt. Extravagance, luxury, catching a staph infection, anything's possible for just $10,000 per night when you stay at a hospital without health insurance. A hospital without health insurance, a 10-star price for a 1-star experience.
So you'd have to figure out how we deploy a strategy like that. How do you turn something like that into a promotion for your company, if you're maybe you're an insurance company? But that satire works. Why does satire work? Satire works because it's true, and it's funny because it's true. So that's our seventh marketing concept that you can test. So I keep hitting the keyboard. I apologize. So what does this all mean? So we've got concepts. We've got categories of testing. We can test different things. It's not just all about concepts. What we just went through, pricing, satire, I would call those concepts, right? But there are other things that we can test as well. We can test things like audiences. Audiences might be your location. If we want to keep it very simple, it could be the region, right? If clinic in Greece, I'm targeting France, I'm targeting Americans, whatever that might be, that's a snapshot of your audience. Now, we can drill in deeper and we'll get into a little bit of that, but that's overall your audience. Who are you targeting? Your objective. So concepts, let's get this out of the way. Concepts, audiences, if you ask me, I would tell you those are the two biggest things that you can possibly test. The rest, these other two categories, are much more minimal, but are things that you should still know even if you're not a marketing professional, because if you can influence your marketing department, if you understand what they're doing, you can influence them, you can even lead them in the right direction. So objectives, that comes down to a couple of things. One is, what is our objective as a business? Is our objective brand awareness? Is it lead generation? If we dive in a little bit deeper to a departmental focus, for example, in marketing, are we looking to build up our social media? Because that's a different objective. If we're looking to get likes on Facebook and get people engaging with our activity and build social proof on an ad, that's a very reasonable strategy, depending on what you're going for, that has its place for sure. But it's a completely different objective than sending traffic to your website. So your objectives, you have to understand, be keen of what objectives you have. Like on Facebook, for example, and on Google and every other network, you have different objectives you can go for. And those are two of them. Two of several others, but traffic is an objective. Social engagement, that's another objective. Likes on your page, right? That's another objective. So there's all these objectives that you can focus on to achieve your end result. And then we've got placement. So your placement can mean a few things. One thing that I would preface that with is your placement could be the network overall, right? You can test different networks. So that would be, for example, Facebook versus LinkedIn, right? If we're looking to attract patients, I'm not sure the cost of advertising on LinkedIn would be as reasonable. If we're looking to build up referrers, whether that be referring physicians or facilitators or whatever that might be, maybe you'll find them on LinkedIn. That's a different story. That's a different webinar. But we can test just simply Twitter versus Facebook, Facebook versus LinkedIn. We can test our search channels for paid search. We can test Google versus Bing. Bing isn't very big around the world. It's not very big in America, but just examples. And then once we find out our network, placement really doesn't refer to the network. Network is really above all of this in its own macro category, but placement would be specifically the word placement. If you're in marketing and advertising, that is going to be specific to the network, such as on Facebook. Maybe on desktop, my desktop ads are performing very well, but mobile, they're not performing very well. Well, if you're not looking at those things, then you're wasting your money, because what we can do is we can find out, okay, everybody on desktop is clicking my ad, they're engaging with my ad, but on mobile, people are on the go, people just, I don't know, they're not engaging with the ad. So why are we running the ad? Let's cut the ad off, let's focus on what works. And then we can test the placement of desktop. We've got the newsfeed versus the messenger on Facebook, if you're familiar, versus the right column. There's all these different things. So less important, much less important than concepts and audiences and those testings, testing categories. However, good for you to know. And then if we want to get to just specific examples, procedures, that's something that you can test that would fall under, that would likely fall under the concept category. Concepts, I should mention, creative is a word that describes the ad as a whole. The ad creative, when you hear ad creative, well, that means if you're on Facebook, if you're running a Facebook ad, that would be your headline, that would be your media, whether it's an image or a video. You can even test things like that, image versus video. You've got genders, which are demographic. Expats, are they living here, or are they expats, or are they residents, are they expats? You can test things like that. Online transactions, maybe you'll find that because of the medical service that you offer, whatever that might be, maybe people who are engaging in online e-commerce are more apt to engage with your ad because of what your product or service that you're offering. So you can test things like, are they frequently purchasing online? Their travel behavior, demographics again, you can test that. Marital status, age, location, all these demographics. So these are just some examples of specific things. Now you can test one against the other, like, okay, you can test within a within one of these specific variables, like age. You would want to test just that category. You would want to focus the variables on just age. Like, if we want to figure out what age works, then the only thing that we want to test is the age. We wouldn't want to test the age and the marital status and the gender all at once. That doesn't really make sense. We need to have a controlled testing environment and just test age. Is it 65 and up that's performing the best? People are really engaging. Or is it 35 to 64, whatever that might be? That's how you test things. So we're going to run through very quickly how you can deploy a campaign on Facebook. Taking it home, very basic steps. Can't get too deep into detail here, unfortunately, but I think this should help. A lot of people found this very useful at the conference and were very interested in this part, and I had to rush through it. But step zero is you need to have a website. Step one is you need to have a Facebook page in order to advertise. Step two is you need a Facebook pixel on that website. You need to be collecting data on your audience. You need to know that somebody spent time on your webpage. Step three is focused on the campaign. You have to actually create the campaign. Within the campaign, you would create a single ad set. I'm giving you a little bit of technicality here, but people seem to appreciate this. So you've got your campaign. Within your campaign, if you want to think of it just with easier words, you have your campaign. You have your single ad set, which you can call your sub campaign. You focus on just one sub campaign, right? We build our creative ads assets. So that's going to be, you know, our images, our video, whatever we want to put together. We need to gather that stuff. We need to start inserting that. We need to differentiate our headline concepts. We want different concepts. If we're focused on, we should always test one thing at a time, like I said, right? So if we're testing concepts, let's test concepts. Let's not test the demographics at the same time while we're testing the headline concepts. If you're a little bit more advanced and more seasoned, you can try that. But just to start out, you can almost consider the two slides that we just discovered, that we just looked at, the specific variables and stuff. You can almost just forget about this stuff. This is just extra information to take home with you. But for the purpose of this, if you're testing those seven concepts that we mentioned, then maybe we've got headlines that are focused. One is focused on price, One is focused on convenience, whatever that might be. You have to narrow down your focus for testing if you're going to be successful in discovering that winner. And then when you're done with that, when you've got your campaign built, when you have all your variables in place, you've got all your concepts being tested, you're ready to launch your campaign. And when you do launch your campaign, there's a couple variables that you want, a couple KPIs. KPIs stand for key performance indicators, a couple metrics. There's a couple metrics that you want to look at, your marketing team wants to look at, that you want to look at with your marketing team. And the biggest one, I would have to say, is your click-through rate. Your click-through rate is what how many people are actually clicking on your ad. And what that's going to tell you is how effective your ad is, right? The first step of that cycle that we talked about is attraction. So if you're not attracting, you can't move on to step two, which is conversion. So the first thing that you need to look at is my ad working? If your ad is working very well and your click-through rate is above 1%, 1% is probably the average that you might achieve. Much will fall under 1%. Some will fall above 1%, and you'll go into 2% click-through rates. That means 2 out of every 100 people that see your ad are clicking on it. You have to be careful when you're looking at these numbers. I want to be careful in giving you too much information, not to confuse you, but when you're looking at click-through rates, I think if you're using an agency, this knowledge should help you. But what you should take away from this, if you're already having an agency or your marketing department already doing this stuff, you want to look at what click-through rate are they actually analyzing. If they're giving you reporting and telling you what ads work and what don't, what is the specific click-through rate? Because there's several click-through rates. Your general click-through rate, which is described as all click-throughs, is not the click-through rate that I would be looking at in order to discover a winning advertisement. The reason is that that would include anybody who's clicking on anything. That would be anybody who is clicking on see more to read your full post. That's anybody who's clicking on comment, clicking on like. That doesn't really help us. We want to know our link click-through rate, or your outbound click-through rate, because that's going to tell us how many people were actually interested in the ad and went to the website, assuming we're running a traffic campaign, for example. So that's one, and others include cost per click and stuff like that, which we unfortunately just don't have the time to get into detail in terms of how you can test that stuff, what it means to you, et cetera, et cetera. But the big takeaway is going to be your click-through rate. So now that we've got all that out of the way, I'm looking at some of the questions, and I think that this should answer some of those questions. Questions are coming in about very specific questions, like, what can we do to attract North Americans to come to Colombia to do plastic surgery, reconstructive surgeries, aesthetic health. There's a couple others that that are very specific, like this question from Andrea. And the reality is that we can't get into a Q&A, and even if we could, we just don't have time for it. But even if we could, I can't even answer that question without having an in-depth conversation. But what I can tell you is that we have an opportunity. I promised you in the beginning, when we were looking at our table of contents and our what we were going to be discussing today, that we would talk about an opportunity for you. How you can use this information. I just gave you a bunch of information. It's very likely, and I sure hope so, and give me feedback. If otherwise, give me feedback anyway. But I hope that you've taken something that you can actually use and take back with you. However, we can also do something for you. So right now, we are actually redeveloping four of our leading webs, not our leading, they're ours, but they're leading on the web. When you search for medical tourism keywords of multiple sorts, you'll see our websites. And those websites, one is the Medical Tourism Magazine. The second is the Medical Tourism Index. The magazine is the publication. The index is our research. We do some research every few years about the industry that is very valuable to business professionals. Another one is our events website, where you, if you happen to, you, most of you, I think, would have saw for our event in Abu Dhabi, our WMTC World Medical Tourism Congress event. That website and our events associated with that, that is one of the websites. And then we also have medicaltourism.com, which originally was focused on the patient, right? It's all about the patient being able to find healthcare wherever they are in the world. And what we're doing is we're taking these websites and we're combining them into one website. So I'm going to show you a sneak peek just because you're on this webinar. This website is in development, so it's not live. It is live, but we are using a, so if the truth is, if you go and steal this domain, you can pull it up in your browser just like we can. But it's not official yet. This will be medicaltourism.com. Right now it is still a development website, and we're still working on it. And what this is it combines everything. Like I told you, you've got a place that is going to be for, it's going to be the digital destination for professionals and patients. So we're combining everything into one place to have one flagship for the industry. Our long-term vision is, no matter who you are in the industry, if you're a patient or you're professional of any sorts, we've seen there's multiple sorts with us today, that you can find what you need and you can advance your organization with this website, however that might be, whether it's attending events, whether it's getting research on the industry, whether it's reading a publication, whatever that might be. And so here's just a quick overview of what is to come. This is our one of many pages that are in development, and this is our homepage for the website. And the cool thing about this is that you can actually have a piece of this. So imagine one of these being your destination. Guatemala, you're going to hear from in a little bit, and we're going to show you what's in progress there. But you can actually get featured on our website. So you can actually have your hospital, your clinic, as a provider, you can be featured on our website. As a government for your region can be featured on our website. Now, you're not going to understand everything just by looking at this. Like I said, it is a website that is in development. But the point here is that, for example, Guatemala, every website, every page that I'm going to, you'll see, this is now, we're focused on the Medical Tourism Association, the About Us of America, Medical Tourism Association. But what you see, the first thing you see is Guatemala, right? We're promoting Guatemala. And this is cool because this can be your clinic, this can be your hospital, this can be your region. And let's just take a look at what that means. So if we come back to our presentation, I want to show you an opportunity that that a lot of people like Guatemala and Raul, who you're here from in a bit, are very much interested in. If you don't fall into this category, there's still plenty of ways that we can work together with you, even if it's not medicaltourism.com. But just take a look, because I think you might find it interesting, especially with the questions that I'm seeing. So we're building websites. We're calling them microsites. Imagine your very own microsite, your very own landing page on medicaltourism.com. And on that website that we're going to look at in just a few while we run through these slides, you're going to see services, you're going to see specialties, you're going to see cities. This is a region, this is a destination microsite, so it would be a little bit different. If you're a facility, it would be a different sort of concept. But we're focused on the tourism side, right? So the idea here is that as a patient, you can come to this website, you can see this microsite on medicaltourism.com, which is getting all the traffic. We'll run ads for you, we'll do organic and paid advertising for you. And if I'm a patient, I can find out everything I need to know about your destination and about your or about your clinic or hospital on this website. So after I'm done, I've got a place where I can get a quote. Or I can get some sort of information. In fact, what we typically do in the marketing world is we don't just have a form that you just leave your information, we'll contact you later. Like I said, this is all in development. We're about to launch very shortly, though, with Guatemala. In this case, you would typically want to offer them something in order to get the lead, right? Get the potential patient. You can't really expect just get a quote, have a form that says just get a quote and nothing else to be your most successful marketing conversion strategy. You typically want to do something. You want to do something for them, give them something. So what we're going to do with Guatemala is they have put this guide together, like 10 tips for traveling, for patients traveling in Guatemala. Well, now there's some value that I can get out of this. Yeah, I can get a quote, but I can also get something in return that I can look at instantly, right? Like that. I submit the form, I look at it instantly. So great opportunity there. And if you want to see it live very briefly, this is what it looks like live. It's a very, you see that it's very interactive. As a patient, you want to be, as a website browser, if I'm looking at a website, we want our website browsers, viewers, to be engaged. We want them to interact with our content. We want them to interact because if they interact, if things are interesting, if things are this very modern website, very responsive, if we open this on mobile, it's responsive, but it's also beautiful, it's also engaging. And because we can engage people, though, it's much more likely when you see a website that looks like this, you're going to pay attention. You might even scroll through, but you're going to pay attention. Not only are you going to pay attention and be interested, but you're also, as a region, in this case, Guatemala, you're looking extremely professional and credible with a website of this caliber, right? With the website development that looks like this, you look like you know what you're doing, right? And you care. And if you want to go and research some statistics on your own about how much that matters and how much website design matters, there's been several studies, and so far all of them I've seen on the low end, about 70% of people, on the high end, about 95% of people actually judge your company, based on your web design. So if your website is old, outdated, it looks broken, you're actually sending the message to your potential patient that you don't really care. And in an industry like healthcare, you can't afford that type of experience for someone who's not even a patient yet, because they're going to go to somebody else's website and be wowed by their website and say, wow, this is a company that cares. This is a hospital that cares. This is beautiful. And they're going to end up going with them and inquiring with them rather than you, because you didn't invest in your digital presence. And if we come down here, you can see that lead capture, which we'll be working on optimizing and to get those leads for Guatemala, FAQs and connect with Guatemala. So there it is. If you are interested in something like this, let's connect. We can get your region, we can get your hospital clinic, we can get you featured on medicaltourism.com. And what you'll get from that is you'll get the benefits of organic traffic combined with paid advertising, and you'll become a market leader eventually. Is it going to happen overnight? No, but you're going to be taking the major first steps that you need to take to become a market leader. And in the same, if we decide to move forward in the month of December only, we'll even grant you the same special discounted pricing that we gave to my friend Raul, who is coming up just now with Jonathan, to talk to you a little bit about Guatemala and their investment in medical tourism as a region. So Raul and Jonathan, if you want to join us and come back on, we can have a nice little fireside chat and learn a few things.
So I think a great presentation makes us think quite a lot. Raul, thanks for joining us from Guatemala today. I'd love for you to share us who's AHEXPORT, and you know, and what is your goal and initiative, and how have you marketed in the past in this industry?
Excellent. Buenos dias, buenas noches, buenas tardes, good afternoon, good morning, good night, wherever you guys are. My name is Raul. Don't try to pronounce my last name; it's gonna be catastrophic. I'm from Guatemala. I work at AHEXPORT. AHEXPORT is the Exporters Guild. We gather a cluster of different exporters from agriculture, manufactured goods and services. And we're working on the services sector specifically with medical tourism. Guatemala is already a sought out destination for tourism, for experience tourism, adventure tourism. But for the past 12 years, the cluster of doctors and hospitals has been working on coming together and presenting ourselves as a one specific cluster to the world. We know that there is a lot of opportunities out there for medical tourism, for people from the States and Canada and Europe to come down here to Guatemala and have world-class treatments and enjoy the tourism part of our country. So we've been working on this for 12 years, but this year it really got a kickstart with this project. And in this project, we began analyzing that we have to work together as a cluster, you know, dentists, plastic surgeons, hospitals, tourism companies, hotels, tour operators, so we can portray ourselves as a tourism destination that has the ability, the capacity to cater to the demands and needs of customers from the States, and from Canada at first, and also has the ability to wow them with our country, with the Mayan heritage that we have, with the Spanish colonial heritage that we have. And so people can come down here and really make an experience of a dental treatment or a plastic surgery treatment.
Has Guatemala before kind of come together and tried a marketing initiative to bring more patients? Has that happened before?
Not really, no. We as the Exporters Guild, we know that we play an important role in the entire tourism ecosystem here in Guatemala, medical tourism ecosystem, but we also have government, we have the universities, we have people from other parts of the world that help out with cooperation, etc. But no, we haven't had the opportunity to come together. Mostly it has been independent efforts by doctors and hospitals that try to work it by themselves. And as Brandon was mentioning, well, it's different. If nobody knows me, nobody knows who I am, I'm betting probably a lot of our viewers don't know who a Hexport is or was up until right now. You can Google us. It's difficult to be able to get to that customer that you're looking for, probably in Virginia, probably in New Jersey or, Vancouver. It's difficult because they're not going to know that you are who you say you are, and they're not going to trust as easily your website if you're, let's say, sanpedrohospital.com, it's an example. They're not going to know who you are because it's difficult to position yourself in a world that has 10,000 messages all over your mobile phone, your computer, from Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, etc. So it's been an effort. We've tried to do it, but it's just until this year that we've been able to come together and portray ourselves again as one big cluster, as a country, as a medical tourism destination.
And that's important, coming together.
Oh, exactly, because you join the efforts. We've been able to work on the back end of the processes. The back end of the processes mean that we already understand that who plays which role in a specific customer experience. The dental part, well, let's leave that to the DDS, hospital part, let's leave that to the hospital. But the tourism part, we need to have tour operators that know and understand the specific needs of medical tourists. We need to have hotels that understand the requirements. If you're going to have hip replacement surgery, you won't expect a customer to be able to do gliding or hand gliding the next day. So we have to come together and be able to understand which role you play. It's like a football team, like a soccer team. You have to know where you are and what you're good at. And only as a team effort, you'll be able to get the results. And that's what we're working towards here in Guatemala, to be able to come together and work on these results. We understand that we have the potential, Guatemala has the potential to become a interesting pole of, magnet of medical tourism here in Latin America.
It's not easy to pull everyone together, right, and create an initiative. Because that's a lot of different stakeholders and then a lot of chiefs. I'm sure it's been a lot of work for you.
Oh yeah, exactly. Because everybody, at the end of the day, everybody wants to do business. Let's say the medical professionals, the tour operators, everybody wants to do business. But it's difficult to be able to get to know which part of the puzzle you'll be filling, and in return, which part you'll be getting as a return on sales, revenue, etc. But once you lay out the plan, you get to a point where you say, okay, I'm ready. I know I play quarterback. I know I play tight end. I play wide receiver. So I know which part of the strategy I'm playing. And that's what we've been working on this year. And I wouldn't say luckily, but we've been able to pull everybody together and be able to present ourselves as a tourism destination, you know, as a whole, as a country. So this is the start of a big movement that we believe it's going to bring in also, you know, the different actors, stakeholders of the ecosystem, government, etc.
That's exciting. And it takes a lot of work, but you got to create a solid foundation first and then build upon that and build upon that with all the right stakeholders. Why did you make the move to like do a campaign and a micro site for Guatemala on medicaltourism.com? And what do you hope to achieve from that?
Well, you know, it's interesting because we've been working on the vision of an online marketing campaign, marketing strategy since probably April, May. But we've been discussing a lot this ability to reach more customers and also ability to develop trust with your customers, because I can have a unlimited budget of marketing, of online marketing, but if I don't focus it correctly, if I don't appear on the sites that people typically will trust, then I'm just throwing my money away. So we understood that we're good at what we're doing, which is dental treatments, plastic surgery, world-class treatments with, you know, a modern city in Guatemala City, and the tourism part that, you know, it's already been established. But we were lacking the exposure that can make the customer trust us. And that's where, you know, the partnership with medical tourism came in and played. And we saw a good opportunity of, you know, being able to portray ourselves or displaying ourselves and our abilities in a place, in a site that it's already been, you know, visited by a lot of customers. It's already has established name. So, you know, in marketing terms, it's already got a top of mind, as opposed to, you know, a brand new website that will take us probably 2-3 years to establish. So this is kind of a fast track for us to be able to link with Medical Tourism Association and have this microsite portray what we're doing and what we can offer customers, again, states, Canada, and, you know, in the future, Europe.
Yeah, it's you know, and I think that it's also tough in this industry to look at how do I acquire patient leads, because there's a lot of companies out there that will sell patient leads and have done it for years. And I think a lot of the providers have found that they're buying a lead that's been sold to 10 to 20 other clinics, you know? And the other part is it's very difficult to look at where you spend your money. You know, even our organization, as we were moving into our Abu Dhabi conference, we launched all these different campaigns and ad spend, you know, Facebook, Google, all these things to see what works and what didn't. One of them was like, wow, this is amazing. These results are amazing. But at the end of the day, the results initially looked really good with all the traffic, but then we found it wasn't quality traffic and turned it off. And so, and I think the hardest part is in today's world is with all the channels of where you can reach potential patients. It's, you know, like which one is going to work for you. And you could spend Guatemala could spend $100 million, you know, across Facebook and Google, maybe have an impact, maybe not. I think some people just think if they spend money, you know, they potentially get a return. But it's simply not that easy. What are your goals with the medicaltourism.com microsite? What do you hope to have happen? And then will that change anything for the Guatemala initiative in 2020 or 2021?
Well, what we're looking for, what we're, you know, hoping for to happen with our microsite is to get those, you know, qualified leads. We understand that the conversion is part of our responsibility, but we're hoping to get the leads, the qualified leads that we're looking for, estimating, you know, probably 20, 35, 40% increase in patient leads as opposed to what we were doing in the past. Again, because we've been able to come together, we needed an outlet where we could advertise ourselves. We could talk to the customer and portray ourselves in a way that our customer, which is, this is Marketing 101, you cannot cater to everybody at first. So you have to focus. And we've been focusing on a specific, market, target market, the market niche, where we understand what the needs of these customers are and what we can do for them here in Guatemala. But we're hoping for this to be, you know, spark plug, you know, the start of a movement that will be able to bring specialized tourism here in Guatemala, because we depend on tourism, we rely on tourism, and tourism brings in, you know, US dollars, a lot of the US dollars, millions of US dollars per year. But this tourism needs to become more specialized, not only medical tourism, but also adventure tourism, gastronomic tourism. But right now we're focusing on medical tourism, and with the microsite, we're betting on having, you know, an increase in qualified leads that we can take and we can, you know, convert into customers and you know, recurring customers in the future.
What, how are you planning on converting the patients or managing those patient leads? Because I think that's, you know, that's a whole like webinar, you know, so I'm sure people on the webinar are very interested to see, like, have you created, what is your solution that you've come up with?
Well, we've created, you know, a backend system, a CRM system, a customer relationship management system, where we're relying on, you know, phone operators and people in chatbots being able to, you know, talk live to customers. But this is, as you say, a whole other process, which first makes you work on your backend processes and the way you convert a lead, the way you go down the funnel to have the lead become a customer. And then once the lead is, you know, is turned and become, is converted and become a customer, well, you have to take care of him or her in the months before he or she gets to Guatemala. And then once she gets or he gets to Guatemala, you have to take care of him. And then after they leave, you have to follow up on their needs, you know, medically and, you know, specifically their experience here in Guatemala. So the conversion process is really important, and you can rely, you know, on several sites, several systems where you work as a CRM system, and you know which step is your lead is taking before he or she becomes a paying customer.
It's an important process, right? It sounds like you guys really thought it through. I think some people just get the lead and then they disappoint someone and say, work the lead. There's no process in place. There's no strategy. There's no kind of workflow. I think that's the most important part, the workflow. And I see that in a lot of providers too. I think they don't even realize how many patients they lose because they have no process. They have no follow-up. There was one provider we were just meeting with who's actually a local Florida provider. And they have the initial lead go into this one department over here, and then they send one email. And then after that, it gets passed to a different department. A week later, it gets passed to a third, a fourth, and then that's it. And it goes into, disappears into the ecosphere. And in actuality, none of the departments actually coordinate and none of them follow up. And it's like, you know, so I think there's a lot of that's lost out there, not just with, you know, with the existing leads. Like, it's so tough to get leads where people are interested in you. And I think the science comes down to is how do you convert them and get them to come? And then the second most important part is they come. How do we have them have an amazing experience where they become the salesperson for Guatemala or the other destination and become a raving fan? If you were to want one thing to be known about Guatemala in the medical tourism, you know, sphere, like what would you want patients or buyers to know about Guatemala?
Well, I would like to split that in two, you know, world-class treatments at affordable prices. That's it. You know, you come down here, you have certified doctors, you have certified hospitals by you know, international organizations, but it costs you 10, 20, 30%, you know, of the cost that it would in the States. So it would be world-class treatments at affordable prices. And once you're here, you might as well stay and go to Atitlan, go to Antigua, go to Petén, and you'll have a blast.
It sounds like fun. I'm gonna turn it back over to Brandon if he has any questions for Raul and to roll out with the webinar.
Sure.
What's the weather like in Guatemala right now?
Oh, right now it's really, really cool. You know, the rainy season has stopped. We're probably, you know, around the high 70, 75, 77. So it's really, really cool. Right now, it's one of the best times of the year up until, you know, March, where it gets, you know, hotter, but not that hot. Nice.
Sounds like heaven.
Oh, it's a little bit like heaven.
Brandon?
It's entered Florida just a bit. We've got a little bit of that heaven. It's cold for the first time in who knows how long. It's actually cold. Thank you, Jonathan, and thank you, Raul. I mean, based on that conversation, I don't know what else I can really add. I think you covered all the points that we wanted to cover for sure. And I think we're looking like we have great timing, because I promised everybody it would be an hour and a half. And so we're right on schedule. So what I would say to everybody listening, everybody watching, is share your, you know, we would love to have your feedback on this webinar. What did you learn? What did you feel like you should have learned? What could we have done better? What could have been better in the presentation? We would love your feedback. If you are a facilitator, and you are interested in contacting Raul and getting in touch regarding Guatemala and sending patients there, Raul, how can they reach you?
Well, you can reach us at destinationhealthgt.com. Again, that's destinationhealthgt.com. And you can leave us an email there. You can also leave us an email at, well, send me an email, which is Raul, R-A-O-L dot I-L-L-E-S-C-A-S at Ahexport, which is agexport.org.gt. Again, very complicated. Destinationhealthgt.com. Just one quick intervention right now before we go, if I may.
Sure.
The site you saw, you know, the sneak peek that Brandon showed you, is really nice, because it's really very intuitive to complete the information that they're, you know, requiring from you as a facilitator, hospital, or destination. And it can be custom made, you know, because this one that Brandon showed you was, well, obviously it doesn't have anything, you know, just for one hospital. It's for a cluster. So we designed this to, you know, showcase our main cities in Guatemala, the main services that we provide, and things to do here in Guatemala. So it's been a really mainstream, easy process to complete the information of the microsite. There you can see in the bottom page, that's our webpage. You can send me an email there and you can get in touch with us. That'd be great. Esperamos que nos contacten. We're waiting for you to contact us.
Thanks, Raul. Appreciate that. Yeah, and just to recap for anybody who was interested in having a destination or a provider microsite, like I said, this is not a marketing promotion as far as being all fluff. Truly, only in the month of December can we offer you what we offered to Raul as far as pricing goes. We will not get the same discount after the month of December. So if you are interested, let's talk. You can reach me at brandon@goghr.com. That was in the PowerPoint, but I can throw that again in the chat. That's brandon@goghr.com. And while you're at it, like I said, give us some feedback. Let us know how the webinar went. And we hope to see you in the future. We should do more of these. I think the demand is there. I think there's a need for these discussions. So if we get great feedback and you want to see more, let us know. And we will see you shortly.